pray. Heavenly Father, God, we just have so much to be thankful for. Father, there's so many blessings in our lives, Lord, and things that we overlook, Father, but God, we just want to come to you and give you praise and honor and glory for everything, God, that's in our lives. We thank you, Father, for the good and the questionable things that we don't understand. We thank you for all of it, Father, and we thank you for anything, Lord, that would give us an opportunity to find ourselves coming closer to you. Pray for our church, Lord, that you'll bless us here at Center Point. Allow us, God, to be found doing that work, Father, that pleases you. Father, that work that brings you honor and glory. I pray for the prayer requests this morning, Father, that God, that you'll be with each one, Father, and you know the needs. Father, we just pray that you'll supply those needs you see fit. So many, Father, that God, we know that there are the needs involved, Father, and that people, God, have various things going on in their lives, Lord, and whatever it is that anybody here or outside of here may be praying for, Lord, we just pray, Father, that your will be done with it. And I pray, Father, for the service this morning, God, that you'll just touch the hearts, Lord, that you'll prepare each heart, Father, for that part of the message that will apply to them. Lord, that you'll be with me as I, God, just deliver the message you've given me. I pray that I'll be moved out of the way and that you, God, will just come in and let your work be done. Father, you tell us that in your word, God, that we must decrease and you must increase, Father, and that's what we pray for here. Now, Father, just be with us. We read your word. Bless the reading of your word. Forgive us where we fail you. Bless all those who are lost and undone. We ask these things in Jesus' sweet name. Amen. All right. So, most of you know I coach Bryson in football, and I love doing that, but I also coach him in basketball, and basketball is more of my field of expertise than football. Football, I usually, I wore the uniform and all that, but I spent a whole lot of time on the sidelines. And in basketball, not so much. So anyway, our basketball season's getting ready to get fired up, and I'm excited about that. And so I was kind of thinking on what kind of offense I wanted to run this year and everything, because I tried to run, if you know anything about basketball, I tried to run a very simplified version of a triangle last year, and that was a disaster. So I've done a little research, and I'd heard of this offense that a lot of teams were running now, and it's called the read and react. And I was studying on that, and I was like, man, that's pretty cool. I like the way everything worked. But then I got thinking about just the title of it. And just thinking about the title, God just said, you know, there's a message in that. So that's the title of this message today, is Read and React. And I like it. And the name of this offense is there for a reason. And essentially with this offense, the player that has the ball will read the defense and react to it. It's just that simple. You know, and my job is to teach them how to react appropriately to it or give them the tools to do it and then allow them to do it. So pretty much what he's doing is he's looking to make a pass and where the defense is playing. And where they're playing is what dictates where he'll go after he makes that pass. That's what it boils down to. So he's reading something and then he's reacting to it. That's kind of the premise behind the whole offense. It's not tying them down and saying you got to be in a specific spot at a specific time. It's saying you see what's in front of you, now react to it. And teaching them a little bit about how to do that. And some of it will have to come from instinct as well. So anyway, God showed me that this is something that oftentimes is missing in the church today. I mean, he slapped me as hard with that read and react thing to go with the message as I've been hit with anything in a long time. And I was like, oh. And then instantly, I knew where to go. And I knew how to make this come into an illustration. So, if you got your Bibles today, turn to the book of Nehemiah. And if you don't have your Bibles today, go outside and get one. Because we got a whole rack of them out there because Danny hooked us up. So, anyway. So, I want to look at this, and I'll tell you where to go in Nehemiah. Just find Nehemiah first. It's between Chronicles and Job. There's three books in there, Ezra, Nehemiah, and Esther. So, if you can find 2 Chronicles, or Job, flip on up there and you'll find Nehemiah in between there somewhere. It's kind of like a Big Mac, you know, it's in there. So anyway, but I want to look at him because Nehemiah was a very driven man. He had a purpose, and it's interesting to see how his purpose came to light. But just to kind of give you some information on Nehemiah, he was a cupbearer for King Artaxerxes. And everybody knows, if you know anything about history at all, Artaxerxes was the king of Persia. And if you've ever seen that movie, The 300 or whatever, you know, the big 9-foot-tall silly guy that had piercings everywhere or whatever, that's kind of what he was portraying, was Artaxerxes, okay? And as a matter of fact, they called him Xerxes in that movie for short. But nonetheless, so just to kind of put things in perspective for you, the Persians were very powerful people, and obviously the king of Persia would have been the most powerful of those people. And Nehemiah was the cupbearer for Artaxerxes. So he would, when they would bring the wine in or whatever, he would take it and he would take the wine and be the one that actually hand-delivered that, if you would. Now, some people say, and I haven't been able to find it anywhere, and it may be, but some people say that he also would taste it, you know, like they did to make sure there was no poison in it or whatever. But I haven't been able to find that anywhere. But anyway, he was burdened to go to Jerusalem and rebuild the walls that surrounded Jerusalem. And so he prayed about it. You know, and that's a revelation to some people. When they get a burden to do something, maybe you should pray about it. I'm just saying. Some people don't ever put that in perspective. You know, they feel like, man, I really feel like I need to do something about that. I'm just going to go do it. Well, do it under God's power, not under yours. But God heard his prayer, and he softened the heart of Artaxerxes, and Artaxerxes let Nehemiah go. And so he not only let him go, he also provided him the resources that he needed to make this happen. So obviously, we can see God at work here. And if you read it, you'll see that Artaxerxes actually came to him and said, what's wrong with you? You seem sad. Your countenance is sad. You're not happy like I normally see you. But nonetheless, so Nehemiah went to Jerusalem, and he completed the wall in just 52 days. 52 days. Built a wall around the city of Jerusalem. Rebuilt it. It was already there at one point, but it had been destroyed. And with the help of Ezra, who's the priest, he started bringing the people back to God. So he's built the wall. Now he's bringing people back to God. So, oh yeah, just because God is so awesome, he added a little twist to this too. All right, the destruction of Jerusalem took place 140 years before Nehemiah was born. So Nehemiah had never even been to the home of his ancestors or to the holy city, however you want to look at it. He had never even been there. But God laid this burden on his heart. 140 years before this is when all that took place. And if you don't know what happened to the walls, it's when the Babylonians came in and destroyed it and took the Jews, made them slaves. So now, we'll get to our scripture. Nehemiah 8. Nehemiah 8. I'm going to read this whole chapter. And if y'all get tired of me reading every week, seems like I've been reading more, but if y'all get tired of that, then after this message, if y'all still tired of it, then y'all ain't saved. I'm just kidding. That's just a joke when I say that. Don't be looking at me like the preacher said I ain't saved. That's a joke. People supposed to laugh. Thank you. Somebody laughed. That was okay. Nehemiah 8. You found your place. Say, God is good. Good. All the time. God is good. Amen. And all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate. They spake unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding, upon the first day of the seventh month. He read therein before the street that was before the water gate, from the morning until midday, before the men and the women, and those that could understand, the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood, which they had made for the purpose, and beside him stood Mattathiah and Shema and Ananiah and Urijah, Hilkiah, Maaseiah, and on his right hand, on his left hand, Padiah and Mishael and Malachi and Hashem and Hashbadana, Zerachai and Mushalam. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of the people, for he was above all the people. And that's not saying he was above them as in rank or anything. He was standing on a platform that put him above them. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, with lifting up of their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. April's already hit on that this morning. And Jeshua and Benai and Sherebiah and Jamin and Achab and Shabbatai and Hodijah and Maaseiah and Kelatah and Azariah and Jozabad, Hanan, Peliah, and the Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. So they read in the book in the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, which is Tirshatha, and Ezra, Tirshatha is a governor, by the way, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, This day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not, nor weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said unto them, Go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet, and send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. So the Levites stilled all the people, saying, Hold your peace, for the day is holy, neither be ye grieved. And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and to send portions and to make great mirth, because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. And on the second day were gathered together the chief of the fathers and all the people, the priests and the Levites, and Ezra the scribe, even to understand the words of the law. And they found written in the law which the Lord had commanded by Moses. Lost my spot, sorry. That the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month, and that they should publish and proclaim in all their cities and in Jerusalem, saying, Go forth unto the mount, and fetch olive branches and pine branches and myrtle branches and palm branches and branches of thick trees to make booths, as it is written. So the people went forth and brought them and made themselves booths, everyone upon the roof of his house and in the courts and in the courts of the house of God and in the street of the water gate and in the street of the gate of Ephraim. And all the congregation of them that were come again out of the captivity made booths and set under the booths. For since the days of Jeshua, the son of Nun, unto the day had not the children of Israel done so. And there was very great gladness. Also day by day, from the first day until the last day, he read in the book of the law of God. And they kept the feast 7 days. And on the eighth day was a solemn assembly according unto the manner. And thank you for bearing with me through that. But I wanted to read the whole chapter because I want us to keep in mind that this is read and react. Read and react. The first thing I want to point out here is that the people gathered themselves and asked Ezra, the priest, to read God's word. They came to him and wanted him to read God's word. They didn't sit out there and they didn't come into a designated area and sit down and think, well, I got to listen to this again. All right. I got to listen to this guy read straight from these scrolls. Tired of hearing this. That ain't what they said. They came to him and they wanted him to read God's laws. They wanted to hear it. With an approach to things like this, they weren't going to be letting things go in one ear and out the other. And see, there's times here that I can preach and I can look at some people and I can see it go in this ear and I see it squirt out the other side. I see it. Obviously not in a literal sense, but I can see it in the expression on people's faces. You ain't listening to what God is saying. And I ain't talking about me. I'm talking about God. I'm talking about when I'm reading this word and I look up and somebody's looking in outer space because they're just, you know, I don't know. Maybe that's how you focus. Maybe I'm being judgmental. All right, and if I am, excuse me. I'm not trying to be judgmental. I'm just telling you what it looks like. But anyway, they were hungry to hear the word and anxious to be found adhering to the word. So hungry to hear it that they came to him and said, hey, can you read this? Can you break that out and give us what the Lord has to say? Give us what the Lord wants to speak over our lives. So remember now, in Matthew 6:33, what does it say? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, right? So we need to come in here seeking him, okay? And we need to be prepared when we come in here to understand that we can find God and his righteousness and his desires in our life in the reading of his word. See, I shouldn't have to really say anything else. No preacher really should have to get up here and preach a message. Really and truly, in order to have church, all we should have to do is stand up here and read from this word. That's it. Because that's where everything's found. Now, God puts a little extra in a preacher's heart. He calls a man to stand up here and to share with you what he gives that man to share with you. If I stood up here and gave you what my thoughts were on it, it would be useless. But the thing is seeking him starts in this word. Seeking him don't start with coming in here and thinking, okay, I'm excited because we got preacher such and such today or preacher such and such tomorrow, whatever. Seeking him starts within his word. And I love what it says in verse 3. Verse 3, it says, he read from the morning until midday. That means I got all the time that I want. All the time that I want. But more important than that, go down to the bottom of that. All right. And the ears of all the people were attentive. Not some of the people. All right. And not a little bit. It just says, the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law. All the people were paying attention. All the people wanted to know what was going to be said. All the people wanted to know what God expected of them. Do you? Do I? How often do you wake up and say, God, in your prayers, God, what is it that you expect of me today? What can I do for you to better and further your kingdom today? How often do you wake up with a plan of seeking what God has in store for you? How often do I do it? We all fail in this. We all fail in it. But man, if we can get it together, things are going to change. Now here's the thing. Over the next few verses, we get to see a church full of life and spirit. Thought April was going to preach my message up here a few minutes ago. I started to get excited. I was like, man, all right. I knew when she started talking that God is in this morning. I knew it. I knew by the songs that they were singing. It's talking about those dry bones in that song, man. I tell you, I like to see it. It says, I like to see the life back in those dry bones, and I like to see it. And April hit on some things here about praise and things like that. And I was just remembering when I was studying on this, how that reminded me of, and I'm fixing to read it, so just stand by, but it just reminds me of what was right here. It says, and Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above the people. When he opened it, all the people stood up. You ever been to church where they say, please stand for reading of the word? We're probably going to start doing that here. I never put a whole lot of weight on that until I studied this. But nonetheless, and Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, amen and amen, with lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord, their faces to the ground. Folks weren't just sitting and acting like they're just waiting for the final amen so that they could jump up and run out the door. They weren't just sitting here like knots on the log. They weren't giving in when the enemy said, "Oh, don't lift your hand. Don't say amen." How many times have you been impressed upon by the Spirit to praise out loud or to do something that gives a showing of worship, but you've fought it, you've ignored it? I've done it. The people were excited to hear the word read. They were excited to hear the word read, and they were excited to hear the message that the preacher had. They stood up, and they yelled amen, they lifted their hands, and they worshiped in humility. What do you mean by that? It says that they worshiped, it says they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord. They worshiped in humility. We are coming before the presence of a king, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the King of all the universe. We should approach his throne in humility. Praise God. I'll tell you, I would love to have been in that service. Love to. I've been in services like that. I've been in them. And man, there's a stirring that takes place that words can't describe when that happens. I mean, when you have people all over the room that are feeling the presence of the Lord, and the hands are going up, and amen, and hallelujah, and praise God, and all this stuff starts getting circulated, and the preacher, I'm telling you, it transfers right over to the preacher. The preacher starts feeling it. Everybody's feeling it. The praise people start feeling it. Next thing you know, somebody's liable to stand up with a song right in the middle of things. It don't matter. The thing is that is them worshiping the way that the Spirit is impressing on them to worship. Stop trying to quench that, guys. Stop trying to quench it. I look out here when I preach and people just kind of looking at me, and I see some people and they'll get this smile. And I see the little eyebrows go up and all that, and I'm thinking, okay, any minute now, that's going to erupt and something, but it just gets quenched. When a congregation gathers and has this kind of heart for worship, though, things start to happen. They start to happen, and I'm ready. I'm telling you, I'm ready now. I'm ready to see that happen right now, right now. So I just encourage you, don't quench the Spirit. Don't quench the Spirit. But my question is, we've had the reading. We have a reading every week. And it seems like here lately, Lord, I end up reading whole chapters. And that's okay, I think. But nonetheless, my thing is, when we have the reading, when are we going to start reacting? You don't have to react to me. Ain't nothing to do with that. Not asking you to respond to me or whatever. But I am pleading with you to respond or to react to God's word. And I don't mean by jumping up and praising or whatever. I'm talking about in your life. Respond to it, react to it, one way or another. You got the reading, now it's time for the reacting. It's not about the person that's standing up here that's bringing the word or the message. It's about the one that gave the word and gave that message. That's what you got to understand. It ain't about me. It's about God. It ain't about whoever printed this Bible. It's about the one that directed the men to write this Bible. It's not about what message I preached this week or whatever. I'm telling you, and I meant it from the get-go, when I read this, that was it. Church could have been over right then. If we came here with a heart to hear it and figure out how it applies to our lives and how we can take it, make a difference, and be different when we leave out of here. Verse 8 says that they were still reading the book of the law of God and teaching from it. It says, so they read in the book in the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. So they're still reading. They started reading back here early on. Now they're still reading. And in verse 9 shows another reaction. I like this. And you think, well, why would you like this part of it? I'm just telling you, I liked it. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. They wept. Tears come out of their eyes And they wept. Why do you think they wept? The same reason that we should weep when we hear it. We should weep when we hear the reading of this word. The word is given to us to judge and convict. Plain and simple. We are not. We are not the ones to be judging or trying to get you convicted. I'll tell you though, I was having a conversation with a guy at work the other day, and he was talking about, well, I'm going to have to come visit your church someday. He said, I was over there at Fellowship Chapel. He said, I was going over there for a little while, and he's like, man, he said, man, that pastor, and y'all know if y'all been here long enough, I love Scott Price, so saying something about Pastor Scott to me is probably not the best thing in the world to do. But he's like, man, that pastor, he's like, man, he just, always preaching on what you shouldn't do and what you know and all that. And I was like, was you listening? Because I listen to Scott's message almost every week. Was you listening? And then he wanted to talk about the tithes or whatever. He said, how pastor was preaching on tithes or whatever. You know what? Sometimes pastor preaches on tithes, just the way it is, what God gave you. It's not like we're coming in here and saying, hey, you ain't giving enough money, let me hold my pocket open. That ain't what he was saying. I know it wasn't. But nonetheless, he said, so I left out of there feeling like I'd been beaten every Sunday. Really? If you're leaving out of here feeling like you've been beaten, you probably have. It's called chastening. It's called chastening by the Spirit. It ain't nothing to do with me. I'm not standing up here judging you. I'm not telling you that everything you're doing is wrong or whatever. If I see something you're doing wrong and the Lord leads me to do it, I'm going to tell you you're doing it wrong. But that ain't why I'm up here. You should leave here feeling like you've had a little bit of chastening. When this word is opened and read, everything I read in here, there's something in here that applies to you. There's something in here that applies to me. The only difference is I get chastening when I'm studying. I get it before I even get up here, and then I get it again sometimes when I preach it. It's like when I was in school, and I get a paddling at school, I get home, I get another one. So I'm getting twice the paddlings. Y'all just getting one. Don't be getting mad at the preacher for that. It's not the preacher's fault. If I'm reading the word and you're getting convicted or you're feeling judged out of something that's on his way, that's where the whole thing about your toes getting stepped on, that's where that comes from. Don't get mad at me for that. Or do get mad at me for that. But if you do, go home and pray on it. You're getting mad at the wrong person. If you don't leave church beat down every now and then you weren't seeking anything when you got here. You didn't come here seeking anything. You should be beat down from time to time when you come here. Every time? No. There are just as many words of encouragement in this book as there are words of chastisement. You got to understand that too. I know some preachers will preach with a judgmental tone, but that's not what I'm talking about. I don't like to sit out there when a preacher is looking at me and telling me that because I don't have on a white shirt. There's some preachers that believe if you got anything as a preacher, you shouldn't wear anything but a white shirt. Because they say if you're wearing a colored shirt, you're conforming to the world. Really? Jeez. I mean, that's judgmental stuff. That's legalistic things that really don't matter about anything. But anyway, I'm talking about the conviction that comes from hearing God's word. Plain and simple. Hearing God's word and realizing that you're not living the way that God would have you to live. That's conviction. That's the beating that you should take when you get out of here. Or when you leave here, if you feel convicted and you're like, golly, preacher was rough today. No, it wasn't. God's word was pricking where it needs to be pricking. It wasn't nothing to do with me being rough. Now let's look at verse 10. Nehemiah tells them to go back, or to go, and he says, and eat and drink, take care of the ones that don't have anything. All right? He says, go and eat the fat and drink the sweet. Send portions to them for whom nothing is prepared. Now, this puts me in mind of our Psalm 23:5. Okay, in Psalm 23:5, David says, Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You say, well, why does that make you think about that? Here's the thing is, this whole wall rebuilding thing, it wasn't done without resistance. There were outside forces. There were people around there, and they were sending rumors and false things back to Artaxerxes trying to get the rug pulled out from under Nehemiah and all this stuff. But just like reacting and rebuilding the walls in our life will be met with resistance from the devil, and the devil will use our friends, and he'll use our families, and he'll use our co-workers and our finances and temptations. But here's the thing, as David said, thou preparest a table for me in the presence of my enemy. Bless the Lord, God has given us a chance. He's given us the opportunity to sit with him at a table. A table that he prepared for us. Hey man, listen, my wife can cook, and I love to sit down at a meal that she's prepared because I know that it's going to be good. I know that the food's going to be good, but can you imagine sitting down at a table that God prepared just for you? Can you imagine how good that's going to be? Whatever's on that table? Who cares what's on the table, man? If I'm sitting down there and God's sitting there, man, that ain't nothing but good. I don't care what's in between there. I mean, I'm going to appreciate it because he prepared it for me, but that ain't nothing but good right there. But here's the thing, okay? Here's the thing. He prepared the table, all right? And it's up to us at that point to react. We have to react to his invitation. Again, we're going back to reacting there, right? And we've got to do that and partake of the blessings in the face of whatever's going on in our lives. Might be something financial over here. Might be something addictive over here. It might be lust over here. It might be just anger over here. It might be all of that. It might be that things are built up around you and things that you just haven't been able to figure out how to overcome yet. These are your enemies at the time, and God will prepare you a table in the face of those enemies and say, listen, I love you and I got this. I'll take care of it. Are you ready to react to him preparing that table for you? Because they were here. Nehemiah said, go your way and eat the fat and the drink and the sweets. He did this in the face of the enemies that they were dealing with. The things that life was not perfect. They were still working on things. They still had things to do. They were trying to establish things and bring people back to God. And he said, go do this. And guess what they did? Exactly what he said. They went and did it. They went and did it. The thing is, we need to stop making excuses of why we can't react to his word and start applying it to our lives now. Because as long as we say, well, I can't do that right now. I'm not in that position right now. My finances won't allow me right now. I'm just not feeling up to that right now. I feel like maybe the Lord's leading me to do this, but I just don't think I can do it right now. That's the enemy talking. See, that just means that table he's prepared for you, you've let the enemy pull a seat up to it. Listen, when he prepares a table for me, I don't want anybody there. I don't want Christy there. I don't want Bryson there. I don't want anybody there. I want it to be me and him. That's it. I definitely am not going to invite my enemies to come down and take a seat. Look in verse 12. It says they went and did what they were instructed. In other words, they reacted. They reacted to it. Why? Right there, last sentence. Because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. They understood what was declared unto them. You ain't going to understand anything if you sit here and don't listen. If you sit here and think about what you got to do tomorrow, if you sit here and think about what you got to do at church, Chad, I'm going to pull you out in just a minute. Chad is one of the busiest guys I know. He's a foreman for the maintenance crew at Bristol, Virginia Public Schools. And everything in those schools and every building is broke. And that guy's always on the go. He bounces from place to place to place to place. And every time I see him, he's got his phone up to his ear, and I aggravate the pieces out of him about it, make fun of him, tell him he's going to have big biceps from that. But I love Chad, but I just like to give him a hard time on that stuff. But the thing is this. All right? The thing is this. I lost my thought. I completely lost that one. But anyway. All right? The point is this, though. Okay? You've got to be busy for the Lord. And what I mean by that is just when you come in here, don't be so distracted, all right? That's where I was going with that. Chad has all these things to think about. He's got all these things to think about, and he's constantly, he's talking about, he'll come by the school where I work and be fixing something or whatever, but he's telling me about something else he's got to do at the other school, or he's telling me about this is falling apart at this school, all right? That's life, and that's what God's going to delve out to you. But when you come here or when you go anywhere where it's time for you to sit at the table with God, then you need to forget about that. You need to forget about all these outside distractions that the enemy is trying to throw in there. That's where I was going with that. Black eye to the devil. Lord gave it back to me. All right. So anyway, next few verses, they found an instruction about dwelling in a booth. All right, so we've got here, it talks about dwelling in a booth. And you're thinking, what's that got to do with anything? Well, it says, the second day they were gathered, the chief of the fathers and all the people, the priests, let's see, Ezra the scribe, even to understand the words of the law. And they found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded by Moses, that the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month. So, guess what happens in verse 16? Well, if you go down there and read it, you probably figure it out. But the people react to the reading. It says they went forth and brought them, and that means the branches or whatever. They went forth and brought them and made themselves booths. So again, we have an example here of the reading of the law and the reaction to that reading. So I'm asking you, I'm asking us, what are we doing to react to the reading? What are we doing to react to what God has given us every week? All right, I'm closing. Chapter 9, verses 1 through 3 says, now in the 20 and 4th day of this month, the children of Israel were assembling with fasting and with sackcloths and earth upon them, and the seed of Israel separated themselves from all strangers and stood and confessed their sins and iniquities of their fathers. And they stood up in their place and read in the book of the law of the Lord of their God 1/4 part of the day, and another 1/4 part of the day they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God. Okay, so there's 24 hours in a day. I need 6 hours of you to listen to me reading. And then after that, I need you to spend the next 6 hours confessing your sins. Y'all ready to give that to me? Ain't nobody volunteering for that. All right. The point is they spent 6 hours listening to the law being read, and then they spent the next 6 hours reacting to the law being read and confessing their sins. Now, does that mean that it was a public confession? No. They were confessing their sins to the Lord. I hope when you go into your prayer room and spend your time in meditation and prayer with God that you can do it in a manner that you can confess everything, because you know if you've done wrong. Don't try to make excuses to God. Don't try to cover it up, sweep it under the rug. He knows, and you know. Confess it to Him. If you want forgiveness for something, you've got to tell Him what you want forgiveness. Father, forgive me where I fail you. Really? How about being a little more specific? Father, forgive me for looking on that woman with a lustful eye today. Father, forgive me for overspending today. Father, forgive me for being greedy today. Father, forgive me for not being in your word today. Name. Confess that sin. React to what His word is doing to you. Now, last, Nehemiah 10:39. For the children of Israel and the children of Levi shall bring the offering of the corn, of the new wine, the oil, unto the chambers wherein all vessels of the sanctuary and the priests that minister and the porters and the singers, and, pay attention to this last line, we will not forsake the house of God. Do not forsake the house of God. Does that mean that you're just not going to come here? Nope. You can forsake the house of God with your hind end planted right where it is right now. If you come here and all you can think about is what's going on out there, what you got to do at work tomorrow, what game you're going to watch today, what where you're going to hunt next week or whatever. If that's all you can think about while you're sitting here, you are forsaking the house of God. Come here seeking Him. React to the reading. So my question is simply this. Are we ready to read and react? Are you ready to read and react? Are we ready to see the explosion that can take place in our church and in our lives when we react to God? Are you ready for that? Are we ready for it? I'm going to guess no, because nobody's reacting to anything right now. That's all good. All right, that's between you and God. So listen, read and react. When God's word is read, you need to be ready to react to it one way or another. Bow your head and close your eyes.